Hear about Arnos in the smart cities.
Let's see if technology works. When you talk about technologies do not work.
It's working.
Well, while Milena is downloading the presentation, here we are. Let me first of all thank a lot Zivka, Nikoleva, who invited me to this conference. It was the possibility to me to meet a fantastic team, and I really hope we will be able to work, to partner. As far as I am concerned, my name is Francesco Grillo, I'm managing director of a think tank and a management consulting firm called Vision, which is quite a key word today, probably. It's a spin-off of McKinsey. I'm also advisor to Italy's Minister for Universities, Research and Education. I was advisor also to the previous minister, so it was a little bit across very different governments. And I'm advisor to the European Commission. I'm visiting scholarly talks for university, and I teach at Sant'Anna University in Pisa. By the way, I am very, very happy also because this conference is dedicated to knowledge cities and knowledge. I must say that I do not have the impression that we live in smart cities. I think European cities are still quite stupid. If you look to numbers, and numbers are still quite important, but also to the perception that ordinary citizens have got of the place where they live. Of course, there are more and less stupid cities. Vienna is probably one of the smartest in Europe. Rome is one of the most stupid cities that you can think of. Also, I don't think that we still live in a knowledge society. Notwithstanding, it's very, very clear that if we do not immediately adjust knowledge, if we do not immediately put knowledge at the center of the political agenda, or the agenda of the mayors, or the agenda of the government, of the national governments, the agenda of the European Union, we are stuck into a traffic jam. I would be more realistic, pragmatic, to be visionary. Otherwise, probably we are probably closed into a self-referential community of innovators with very little grip on the political agenda. This is a very, very important thing. Well, I have a sort of 12 minutes, netting for the introduction. So just 3 minutes for each of the four messages that I want to convey. First of all, it's not true that urbanization is an unstoppable process. At every single conference of smart cities, we hear from some consultant that cities are growing and that they will be growing forever. This is not true, if you look again to numbers. This is what is happening at world level. These are the cities with more than 10 million people. In fact, this rise has been exponential. We had only two cities with more than 10 million people in 1990. Today we have 37 cities with more than 10 million people. However, this process, this phenomena, is almost entirely about the developing world. Today, out of those 37 cities with more than 10 million people, 10 that are attended in China, and China, by the way, the Chinese cities are 4 out of the 5 largest cities of the world, and only 5 are in G7 countries. In fact, if you look to the European picture, the numbers are completely different. These are the capital, the 10 largest capital cities in Europe, and if you see the population, in fact, the share of people who live in capital cities in Europe is decreasing. I mean, there was somebody many years ago who used to say that the number of people is an indicator of the performance of a society. This guy was Jean-Jacques Rousseau. But in fact, if you see the two cities which have been growing quite a lot in Europe are Vienna and London. The other cities are all sort of stagnating in terms of population. As far as Sofia is not here, but it's more or less the same picture. Although Sofia is changing very fast, and it is a beautiful city. At least it's more beautiful than Bucharest. This is quite normal, by the way. Cities they do not grow forever. There are two major faults behind the growing of cities and then the decline of cities. The first is the economies of scale, but also economies of fact knowledge. People tend to get together in London, as we know, because there is a critical mass of competence on finance and not only on finance. So people tend to get together mostly to share knowledge. But then, at a certain point, these economies of scale, the congestion, the pollution, makes it, in fact, to decrease. The impression is that in Europe, we are more or less in this part of the evolution of cities. Again, second need to be a little bit put in discussion is the paradox of this issue of smart cities. No, we're talking a lot about smart cities. This is the number of articles, scientific articles, that talk about smart cities. They are increasing in an exponential way, and in fact there is a proper industry made of conference, made of consulting also, about smart cities. But which are the results? The result is that we cities, for instance, are still very much dependent on a technology, I'm talking about the car, which has been more or less the same for the last few years, okay? We are still depending on the cars very much. 62% kilometers in European cities are traveled with a car, with a privately owned car, which, by the way, weighs, this is absolutely unbelievable to some engineering, a car normally weighs 12 times more than the transport, than the weight that it transports. It is used for a very little portion of its usable life. It is occupied for less than a quarter of its space, because there is 1 point something on average person per car. It travels at a speed which is 1/3 of its potential. And by the way, it uses energy, still fuel and diesel, which is less than 20% as efficient as the energy on the frontier, which is electric, basically. So these are some of the consequences. I will skip because I have a little time. Climate change, notwithstanding a lot of topics, it is a challenge that we are probably losing. This is what is already happening in terms of rise of the sea level, and by the way, Europe and North America is very much threatened And this, by the way, is what is happening to the quality of air that we were talking before. It, these dots measure the number of times that the presence of PM10, which is already taking a big toll in terms of health, the emission of CO2 is more in the future. This is already very much a damage to health of people. And by the way, Italy, North Italy, Bulgaria and Poland, Antarctica are probably among the worst in terms of quality of air and therefore smartness. Very quickly, there are other parts of the world which are proceeding very, very quickly to correct, to rectify some problems. This is China. China has got a huge investment into infrastructure that is making the country much cleaner, although I mean, the baseline was very, very behind. Again, very quickly, because we don't have a lot of time, what is a smart city? We even have a problem of definition and measurement. There are several ideas, you know, of the visualization of what a smart city may be. We have the visionary picture of Fritz Lang, Metropolis. Then this is from Raffaello. It's a perfect city. The only problem with Raffaello is that there are no people in the place. Then you have London and Rio de Janeiro, which is very beautiful at the least. Definition of smart city. To us, a smart city is a strategy to solve one by one, in a measurable way, the problem that we were referring before. So this is about the car, the self-driving, the pooling, the sharing, the electric, the smaller paradigma are all not only technological, but organizational and societal change that need to be applied to each of the problems that we were referring when remembering that cities are still not smart. The same thing applies to house, the same thing applies to waste management, for instance. I think it's important to say a little bit what, in our opinion, is an approach to go towards knowledge cities, knowledge communities. The very important thing is, and this is also about probably a change that even the European Commission has to do, has to apply to its own program on research, especially as far as cities is concerned. We need to start from defining the precise problems to be solved, even in a measurable way. Then there are challenges to be put forward to a community. It is very important that we have experiments. Experiments means, when we are talking about innovation, also giving us the possibility to fail. This is a very essential, because otherwise it's not innovation. And once the experiment has been deployed, there is an assessment. If the thing has worked, it will create political return in terms of consensus. Otherwise, we have knowledge, even from failure, about what works and what does not work. This is basically the key words, in our opinion, to knowledge society and knowledge city. It is very important. I think the most important thing is the citizen. Citizen must be part of the change, must be a very, when we talk about citizen, it's not only bright people, but also the elderly, the children, the families, that they are absolutely important. They cannot be changed, cannot happen if citizens are just spectators of a show which goes on television. To conclude, I want to say that to me, particularly, it was very important to participate to this conference on knowledge today, because it has been really for me personal reason. Last week, one person was extremely important to me, passed to another dimension. He was the best professor of philosophy that I met, and he was 100% about knowledge, and this person was my dad. Thank you.